Good evening, or good afternoon, everyone. My name is Catherine Corneal. I'm the chair of the Department of Theology, and in name of my colleagues in the department, in name also of the School of Theology and Ministry and the Church in the 21st Century, I want to welcome you all to this second distinguished lectureship in interreligious dialogue. This lecture is made possible through a generous gift from a BC alumnus and trustee of Boston College, Brien O'Brien, and his wife, Mary Hasten, and continues a tradition of real commitment to interreligious dialogue, to serious theological engagement between religions at Boston College. This year, we have a very special occasion because we are commemorating 50 years of publication of the Vatican II document Nostra, Aetate, which was really a sea change in the relationship of the church to other religious traditions. The document deals with the relationship to other religious traditions in general, but it was really the relationship to Judaism that was the occasion for the document, and the focus on Judaism is really the main focus of the document Nostra Aetate. So we have decided this year, therefore, to focus on Jewish-Christian dialogue, and we have a wonderful panel here this evening to speak about this topic. And to introduce our speakers, I invite my colleague Ruth Langer to the podium.
Thank you, Catherine. Today is not only, this year is not only the 50th anniversary of Nostra Aetate, but today, literally today until sunsets, is Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Memorial Day on the Jewish calendar. 70 years ago, as the Nazis crumpled, the Allies discovered and liberated one site of horror after another. Work camps and extermination camps in which they had succeeded in murdering about one-third of world Jewry, along with Roma, gays and lesbians, political prisoners, the mentally and physically disabled, and others like Slavs who did not fit their vision of Aryan society. It's in the wake of this horror that the Christian world started confronting what had happened in its midst, and that eventually resulted in Nostra Aetate. Our world of dialogue, then, is in the scale of human history, something new and something spurred by horror. Today, particularly in light of the violence being perpetrated against Christians in Africa and the Middle East, and the Pope's call this last Sunday for a Jubilee Year of Mercy, we pause to reflect on this new reality. Our reflection is going to be informed by the thought of our primary speaker today, Father Dr. Manfred Deselaers. Born in Dusseldorf, Father Deselaers is a Catholic priest from the diocese of what I know as Aachen, but he listed as Aix-la-Chapelle, one of the most ancient dioceses of Northern Europe. He studied in Israel. He spent a year in year and a half in Israel, in study and in service, before going to study theology in Tübingen, and then in Chicago. And he was ordained in 1983. In October 1989, he went to Poland to help in endeavors towards German-Polish reconciliation. And since 1990, he's been living in the town of Auschwitz, where the Nazis located their most infamous camps, Auschwitz and Birkenau. He completed his doctorate in 1996 at the Pontifical Academy of Theology in Krakow, writing on God and evil in the light of the biography and statements of Rudolf Hess, the commander of Auschwitz. And this was published subsequently in German and Polish, not yet in English. Oh, it is in English? Oh, that wasn't on the website there. Good that it's in English. He now dedicates his life to German-Polish reconciliation and to Christian-Jewish dialogue at the Center for Dialogue and Prayer, located just outside the Auschwitz camp in Auschwitz. There, he is responsible for its program department. In addition, he serves as a guide for the Auschwitz-Birkenau State Museum and teaches at his alma mater in Krakow. He's also a member of the International Auschwitz Council. His work has been recognized not only by those involved in Holocaust studies and Christian-Jewish dialogue, but he's also received crosses of the Order of Merit from the governments of both Poland and Germany. The title of today's lecture, Experiences with Dialogue at the Edge of Auschwitz, echoes the title of another of his books. We look forward to learning with him.
Thank you for the invitation and nice presentation. I want to invite you to begin with me with a moment of silence, and I ask you to get up because today is Yom HaShoah, the commemoration day of the Holocaust, and in Oświęcim, where I am working, living, today is, or was already, the March of the Living. Jews from all over the world coming to commemorate the Holocaust, the extermination of Jews in this place and all over Europe in those times. And for me, it's important that all talk about Auschwitz, at the edge of Auschwitz, begins with silence and listening and honoring the dead. And this is why I would ask for some seconds of silence, honoring those who have been killed there. Thank you. I am now an old man, but when I was in the age of your students, or a little bit younger even, finishing high school in Germany, I did not want to go to the army, and I decided to make a civil service with an organization which is called Aktion Sühnezeichen, Action Sign of Reconciliation, Repentance, Service for Peace. And with them I spent almost 1.5 years in Israel, mainly in Jerusalem, working with handicapped children. This was 1975, 4 and 5. Before we went there, we visited Poland and Auschwitz. And this first visit to Auschwitz for me was a shock. Not only because of the enormousness of what happened there, but also because Germans have done it. And I am still a generation born 1955, 10 years after the war. But in this generation, normally the parents did not talk about the war, and it was not yet an issue in the schools. This began only later. Now it's in the school, Memory of Holocaust, present. But when I was there, I was shocked, and I could not imagine that my people would do something like that. I knew Germans, and I found them all more or less nice. I could not imagine, but it happened. And this was a shock, and made me conscious that it's not enough to be normal, a normal German in this case. I have learned I have to care very much about the direction in which normal life goes and decide, do I join or not? This was the first school of consciousness after Auschwitz for me. And then we worked in Israel. I met survivors. I decided there to study theology. I began to study theology in Tübingen as a layperson first, and after a year in Chicago, I decided not half but fully, so to become a priest. It was very much about the question of hope and the question of peace work and reconciliation work, this decision for me also. Then I worked in a parish in Germany, ordained 83, and the parish in Germany had contacts to Poland. I visited Poland, also Auschwitz, Oświęcim, the Polish city. I met the parish priest there where I am living today. And after coming back, I had the idea I could live with this priest for 1 year like I had been living for 1 year in Israel. I asked my bishop, I was very surprised that he agreed at once. And in 1989, I began to study Polish in Lublin. And since 1990, I live in Oświęcim. When I just began to study in Lublin, the wall in Berlin fell down, and it was the end of communism. It's not my fault, but it was very practical. Everything became easier. And since time I live in Poland, in Oświęcim, not in Auschwitz. Sometimes people ask me, how can you live in Auschwitz all the time? I'm not living in Auschwitz. Auschwitz, thanks to God, is over. There's only Oświęcim and the memory of Auschwitz, but the memory of Auschwitz is very present and vivid. So, the cardinal of Krakow, to this diocese it belonged, asked me, but what do you want to do there? You cannot sit just around and say, I'm for peace. And I could not even speak Polish very well and understand. And he told me, make a doctorate, a PhD. And I said, if only about Auschwitz. And the Polish professor proposed the issue of, look at the commander of Auschwitz. Maybe you can do something with this. My Polish professor from Krakow was a young boy in school during the war. After the war, he decided to become a priest and was a young chaplain, vicar, in Oświęcim, in the city. And then in Wadowice. Wadowice is famous because John Paul II was born there. But in Wadowice also, the commander of Auschwitz was in prison after the war. And so he asked me, can you help us to understand how this could happen, how this man could become the commander of Auschwitz? Because Rudolf Hess was born and raised in a Catholic family. His father even made a vow that he should become a priest. But after World War I, he left the Catholic Church, joined the Ataman and the Nazi movement, became convinced, SS man, convinced, ideologically commander of Auschwitz. And after the war, in prison, he converted to Catholic, re-entered the Catholic Church and confessed. So Catholic in the beginning, Catholic in the end, in the middle, commander of Auschwitz. And my professor asked me, try, maybe we understand something. And this became, I would not ever have chosen the biography of the commander as my issue. But I felt this is a request of the victim side to help to understand the perpetrator side. So I understood that this is a challenge, and also for my faith. People are asking, where was God in Auschwitz? So I began to ask, where was God in the biography of the commander of Auschwitz? So I will not go into this now, but this was a real challenge. It was finished after 5 years. And in this time, the Center for Dialogue and Prayer was built in Auschwitz. The Center of Dialogue and Prayer is a Catholic institution, a Catholic guest house, and it's also a fruit of a Christian-Jewish conflict. Because when communism ended, the Polish population living there wanted to make the memorial place a place of prayer, or have a place of prayer near the so-called museum. In communist times, it was not allowed because the communists were atheists, and the museum played an important role in communist education because the Soviet Union liberated the camp. So they did not want to get this place to have a religious character. But the people around there wanted to pray there. So when communism became weak, the Polish Pope visited after he was elected in 1978, in 1979 also Auschwitz. The local church, Diocese of Krakow, began the installation of a Carmelite monastery, which existed already in Dachau. This brought protests, not in the very beginning, but soon, all over the world, in the Jewish world, not in Poland so much, but abroad, especially began in Belgium. And so there was a very difficult, intensive conflict, Polish, Christian, Jewish, at the edge of Auschwitz, about how to commemorate this place. There were consultations and meetings of bishops and cardinals and Jewish representatives, and they decided the Carmelite monastery will be built in a new place, and a center for dialogue and prayer and encounter and education will be built also. This is the beginning of my center. Not my, our center. This happened already, and the center was already opened when I began to work there. When the doctorate was finished, I said I want to work there, and the Cardinal also wanted me to have there. So the problem was, but what to do there with such a center in Auschwitz? So much about my biography, how it came that I am there. First I was for 2 years, and then another 2 years, and another 2 years. I got the permission of my bishop, and now it's already 20 years. But I want now to talk a little bit about what to do in such a center at the edge of Auschwitz. We did not know, because in the beginning, because the situation was so emotional, and so we began with not doing anything, which sometimes is the best. When there's an open wound, and the open wound is deep and still bleeding, and so deep that it touches the heart, your identity, you cannot say, "How are you doing?" Yeah, so normally I demonstrate it with another person, but you understood. I know my guests are there in Auschwitz because of Auschwitz. Sometimes the memory of Auschwitz for them is very difficult memory. So I do not say always, tell me, how do you feel with Auschwitz? Yeah, it's often better to be silent and not to talk. It's an open wound, because when you touch an open wound, the first reaction is protection. The next reaction is aggression, because aggression always makes distance. Yeah, you idiot, leave me alone. What are you doing? Don't you see? And So don't touch the open wound sometimes. I can touch the open wound when I am a doctor and I know this kind of illness, and if I am asked to do so. But normally I'm not. But this does not mean that I cannot do anything. I always can say, please sit down, rest, have something to eat, to drink. And the most important, I will not leave you alone, I will not run away, even if I don't know what to say. And this for me became the basis for all dialogue. The presence, even if we do not know what to do, we do not run away. The respect for the other who is coming, also with his or her otherness. It's a Catholic house, we have a Catholic identity, but we are open for everybody. So everybody should feel respected and welcome, not only Catholics, of course, with their otherness and with their wounds. Everybody can, but nobody must talk about Auschwitz or only as much as they want to. You're all specialists in dialogue, I guess, so I don't need to say much. But I like very much a proverb I heard, I think it's Jewish, but I don't know the author, maybe you can help me. Someone said, I'm I and you are you because you are you and not me, and I am I and not you. We can talk with one another. So this is my basic conception of dialogue. You need to be aware of your identity to be open for others. Because the other also asks you, I want to know what you really think. I don't want you to be nobody or neutral. You have your identity, can I trust your real identity? What do you really think about me, about us, about the world? So identity is part of dialogue. With our Catholic identity, as a Polish, I'm a German, but with a Polish institution, Polish Catholic institution at the edge of Auschwitz. How could we provide dialogue in this atmosphere where it was so emotional? We didn't know, so we didn't do anything in the beginning besides having a house of hospitality. People who came to Auschwitz were invited to stay in our house, just to stay and to visit the place. And until today, in my concept, our concept about how our work should function, this is the point of departure of everything we do. People are not coming to us because they want to come to a Catholic house or speak with a German Catholic priest in Auschwitz. They come to Auschwitz. They come to meet, encounter the memorial place. And this visit of the memorial places always, almost always, for everybody is very difficult. The first, what we try to do in our center is to help, what in Polish you sometimes say, listen to the voice of this soil, or the dimension of knowledge, to know what happened, to learn what happened, to feel what happened. And this is almost impossible because it was so huge. And many of you have been there even several times. The more I know, the less I understand. But it happened, and it really happened, and it demands to be taken seriously. So there are two camps which are museum. There were 40 sub-camps. There were 40 square kilometers in Interessengebiet Auschwitz, nine villages destroyed. There were 400,000 prisoners in the camps. Half of them Jewish, 200,000 of the prisoners, 150 Polish, 20 one Romas, so-called gypsies, Sinti and Roma, 15,000 Soviet prisoners of war, 400,000 in the camp, but 900,000 never were prisoners because directly from the train they were let into the gas chambers. This is even more difficult to imagine. So it's about 1 million Jewish victims and many others. It's hard, almost impossible to imagine what they have gone through. It's impossible to imagine these numbers, and each of them had a life. It's not possible to imagine 1 million lives disappear. So even to know what happened, to feel, understand what happened is almost impossible. How the German, it was in Germany, not in Poland then, it was the German Reich, Auschwitz was in the German Reich, how the Germans could live on the other side of the river and accept it. This is for me more and more an important question. So already what happened is difficult to grasp, but we try to help, to guide the tools in the so-called museum. Can be more or less scientific and long. We organize encounters with survivors, visit the archives and so on, lectures about history. But the second dimension is reflection. This all works in us. When I say listen to, when I like this expression, listen to the voice of this place, it's clear it's not only about facts. The place has, it somehow is talking to us. It has a message, and we try to understand what does this place want to say us? What does do the victims want to tell us? And what does this mean for me? For me, Manfred, if I would have lived in those times, how would I have reacted? On which side of the fence would I have been? As a German outside, I guess. There were also German prisoners, but of course the majority was outside. How would I have reacted in those times? I don't know really. But how do I react today? And I'm not only Manfred, I'm also a Catholic priest. What does this memory mean for me as a Christian, as a Catholic priest? And I'm a German. What does this memory mean to me as a German? I am a German after Auschwitz. So these are all deep questions and not easy to answer. And there's more questions than answers. It's like a uncertainty of my identity. Whom should I be? Who am I? And then the next dimension is when I go through the camp, I don't know who have been the last years or so, there are now more than 1.5 million visitors each year, and still growing. It's already difficult to organize the visits. But we go there, try to think what was then in those times here, try to think what does it mean for me, and see all the others. We see American school classes or tourists, we see in Japanese tourists, we see in Israeli school classes with their flag. We see Polish school classes and Italian pilgrims, and we think, how is it for them to be here? And obviously it's different. The simplest way to describe the differences is to say when Jews are coming here, they commemorate their people. They try to not forget them, to stay faithful to them, and to honor them by commemoration, stones, flowers, candles. Same for Poles. They want to commemorate their people, stay faithful, not forget them and honor them. But when Germans come, it's not our cemetery. We do not come to commemorate our people, to stay them faithful, to honor them. We are no Nazis. We are other Germans. If we want to commemorate someone in Auschwitz, that's the victims and not the perpetrators. So for us, the majority, vast majority, this is not our cemetery. It's like a critical instance. In German you say Denkmal, Mahnmal, which means memorial, to memorize, but also to think. It's something it gives you to think. So we have a very critical approach from the very beginning to the memory of Auschwitz. So all these others have a different approach. And the wound is always in their identity, but the wound is also between us. Very often I am asked, how is it for Germans to come here? Germans ask me, or tell me, I didn't want to talk German because I didn't want the others to see, to recognize that I'm German. How do the others look at me? How can we trust one another with the memory of Auschwitz? To make it a little bit more concrete, I will try very shortly to describe three differences of the Polish perspective, the German perspective, and the Jewish perspective. Of course, this is generalization, and generalization always is also wrong. But the Jewish memory is the memory of the extermination of the Jewish world in Christian Europe, which what was unimaginable. Most Jews lived in Europe, most in Polish areas. This world does not exist anymore. And why? Because an ideology which said Jews are the reason of all evil, like an illness, like a virus, which is spoiling everything. This virus, this illness, these rats, and so must be eliminated to heal the world. And this was not only an idiotic, it was of course an idiotic ideology, but it didn't remain only an idiotic idea of some idiots. It became the way Europe was organized. Wherever Europe was German occupied by the Nazi regime, Jews were searched, registered, signed, separated, collected, put in trains, and burned in ovens. This is Auschwitz, this is the Shoah. This was unimaginable. Even when the first messages came out, many people could not believe that that's true. And such an educated nation like the Germans would do something like that. Unimaginable. But it happened. And because it happened, it was possible. And because it was possible, it is possible. And because it is possible, it can happen again. So, this deep shock, I think until today, is part of all Jewish identity. If I'm wrong, please correct me, but this is experience of many encounters. And one of the most important answers after the war was the State of Israel. Zionist movement was older, but when the world heard about the Shoah, Holocaust, Auschwitz, the responsible agreed to the founding of the State of Israel. 1945, the war was ended, 1947-8, the State of Israel became into existence. The State of Israel for the Jewish people is so important because during the Holocaust, they did not even have where to flee, because in the end, nobody wanted them. So a homeland for the Jewish people is law in Israel that every Jew all over the world, at every time, at once, can become a Jewish citizen. So I talk about this because I experience Israel's presence also today, the March of the Living is connected with that, at the place. Yeah, so this is some Jewish context of memory of Auschwitz, and Auschwitz should not happen again, so we have a homeland, but also other answers. We must defend human rights for everybody, and so on. And when young Israelis are coming, they're going back, and now they have to defend their country. And very often the vision Auschwitz can happen again is connected with these questions. So for sure this is a very different context of the German context when young German people go and visit. For the Germans, the wound is guilt. We are not guilty now, almost all. But we cannot say we have nothing to do with this German guilt, because I'm German and my people did it. So, but how am I connected with this guilt? Yeah. And part of the German memory is that the direct perpetrator stories as family stories are not told. Normally, after the war, nobody said that I had a family member who was a member in the SS. So the parents did not tell their children, grandchildren. Sometimes they discover and are shocked and ask me to help to find information. The general attitude was, after the war, we begin a new Germany. We don't remember and don't attach to the Third Reich. And anyway, the Allies helped to reorganize Germany. And everybody felt, almost everybody in Germany, that what had happened was not only a lost fight, but a moral catastrophe. We have run into something, we have done something which was morally not okay. And so almost nobody wanted to repeat this experiment of creating a new Germany, this new Germany, Nazi new Germany. But the parents did not talk about with the children. The children born at the end of the war became 23, 45 plus 23 is 68, and the 68 revolution in Germany was very much with the question to the parents, but where have you been, what did you do? And very often there were no real answers. But this generation, who feel this is an important issue, at least in West Germany, made now the whole, all the education institutions, and are getting retired now. Now in the center of Germany, we have the Brandenburger Tor on one side, the parliament on the other side in Berlin, the Holocaust Memorial. Yeah, the Holocaust memory is part of German identity today. This said the president of Germany in January this year. So the memory is present also in school books, in media. But very often it's difficult to connect it with their own family story. Because it's always easier to talk, we suffered, we were been expelled from Poland and so, than to say I'm proud that my father fought for Germany in Auschwitz. This is not, simply not a family story in Germany. So to deal with this, and with the question, how do the other look at me, is not easy. And a word about the Polish perspective, because the Polish perspective still is very different. There are two points which make different the Polish perspective to all others. One is the deep connection with Christianity. The baptism of Poland this year, next year, 1,050 years ago, was the beginning of the statehood of Poland. And the church structures, which were bigger, were the first state structures. And there's a long tradition. I won't go into this now. The second part is the Second World War for Poland began two times. It was attacked from Germany, 1st of September 1939, and from the Soviet Union 2 weeks later, 17th of September. So this double occupation of totalitarian systems is very deep in Polish memory about the Second World War. And from that perspective, the Nazis were neo-pagan, also anti-Christian, finally, and the atheists, the communists were atheists, also anti-Christian, and Polish resistance was very much Christian. And also represents dignity of person, of the Polish people also, because the Germans eliminated Polish leadership, killed all professors, closed universities and high schools. The Soviets killed also Polish leadership, all in wartime, the men are in the army, and they killed all officers. So, and both said Poland is not a country which should have, not a people which should have their own country. They should be a not important part of Germany and Soviet Union. So the resistance was about own dignity. So this, and this is why in Polish memory, Christianity represents dignity of person and freedom of the nation, which is very different to Western approaches, because in Western Europe, liberty, French Revolution had been to be fought for against the influence of the church. The Polish tradition is different. So, when Poles visit Auschwitz, they commemorate these times, these oppressions, and their hope to be respected in a new Europe. This very short about how different the approaches are. Another very different approach is the Russian approach, because for them the main issue is liberation. The Soviet army liberated Europe from fascism. And when all these different approaches come and people go through the camp, commemorate the past and think, what does it mean for me in these different contexts, the answers are very different. So how to come to dialogue? It's not easy. So mostly groups come alone and visit alone. and to come together is difficult. And when the quarrels about the Carmelite monastery broke out, we thought, what can we do? And we gathered people from Hebrew Union Colleges, Michael Siegner, and specialists of Christian Jewish dialogue in Poland and in Germany. And we had sat together in the 1990s, just to talk about what does Auschwitz mean for us. And it was about the religious dimension of Auschwitz and about finding ways for dialogue. And we only published afterwards a list of more than 20 questions. Only questions, we did not have answers. And published these questions and sent them around. And only the Jewish Canadian Congress answered. But there was a general awareness in those times that it's not so easy to deal with these questions and the coming together. But at the same time, many in the general atmosphere changed, because when the communism ended, there was no tradition of dialogue in Poland because it was not possible before. So in the Carmelite quarrels, people who met and participated did not know one another, and I often heard from participants, we did not understand what the other is talking about. Yeah, so there was no tradition of meeting and encounter and understanding, but now there is. That rabbis visit Polish seminars, divinity schools, is normal. Priests make courses in Yad Vashem several times already. There's an international council at the museum. And very, very important is all what made John Paul II for Christian Jewish dialogue. So that the general atmosphere of Christian and Jews and commemoration of Auschwitz has changed from confrontation to finding ways together. And there are prayers together on very prominent occasions. For example, when Pope Benedict came in 2006, there were prayers, there were prayer in Birkenau with rabbis and representatives from different denominations. And meanwhile, around Auschwitz, there grew, environment of dialogue. There's from Auschwitz, the International Youth Meeting Council, where people meet, Polish, German. There's our Center for Dialogue and Prayer, where people meet. And the museum has an international educational center for Holocaust and Auschwitz, where people meet. There's a cooperation with Yad Vashem going on very intensively. So a lot of trust has grown. But still it is an open wound. And so I still think that the most important entrance into dialogue for us at the Center of Dialogue and Prayer is not to make own programs, but to be there and to listen. When I say everybody is welcome, everybody can come, can talk, but must not talk. So in talking with one another, relationships grow slowly. We get to know one another, and these professors which came together to make this list of questions later returned with their students, and we had seminars. We listened together to the soil, we visited together the camp, we listened to our professors, but everybody talked about himself. The Polish professor about his Polish perspective, Michael Signer about Jewish theology after Auschwitz in America, the German professor about the German perspective. And by listening to one another, there grew an atmosphere of trust. And this is the most important, but it's still difficult. But today we can say the experience of these 20 years of dialogue at the edge of Auschwitz are very positive and very enriching. And this is a great victory against the power of evil and against Hitler having the last word about Auschwitz. The power of evil has not the last word about Auschwitz. There are good things happening. There's a power of answering to what happened in Auschwitz. And I feel this work of working for peace and reconciliation and responsibility for the future is also the best way to honor the victims. It's a part of honoring their memory, that this would not happen again.
So much.
Thank you very much, and I think you have a taste of what the educational experience is of being at the Center for Dialogue and Prayer without actually being there. Most memorable for me was the walk to the Birkenau Memorial, praying as we went, a group of Christians and Jews together. We have a formal response to Father Deselaers' talk. Rabbi Daniel Lehmann is a Jewish educator, an innovator, who's devoted his career to pluralistic Jewish education. He became the eighth president of Hebrew College up on the hill in Newton Center in 2008, and he also serves as professor of pluralism and Jewish education there. He has rabbinic ordination from Yeshiva University, where he also received an undergraduate degree in philosophy. And he's done graduate work in Jewish studies and education at both New York University and the Bernard Revel Graduate School of Yeshiva University. Lehmann came to Boston initially to serve as the founding headmaster of the Gann Academy, then called the New Jewish High School of Greater Boston. He publishes and lectures frequently on Jewish education, religious pluralism, and interfaith learning. And he's received numerous awards for his work in these areas.
Thank you, Professor Langer. It's wonderful to be with you. Although I have to say somewhat surrealistic, on this particular day in the Jewish calendar, as has been mentioned both by Father Manfred and Professor Langer, it's Yom HaShoah, but actually the full name given to this day by the Israeli Knesset, the parliament in Israel, is Yom HaShoah V'Hagvura, which means Holocaust Memorial Day and the day to remember the heroism. And this particular date, which was very controversial in the history of marking the Holocaust, to choose this particular date, which falls in between the end of Passover, the celebration of the Exodus of Egypt in the Jewish calendar, and the celebration of the founding of the State of Israel, which takes place soon. The choice of this particular date in between Passover and Israel Independence Day was a choice determined by the desire not only to memorialize the victims and the death cause during the Holocaust, but also the resistance, and in particular the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, which took place beginning on Passover and continued for weeks beyond. So this was chosen in order to link the memorial of the Holocaust also to the uprising in Warsaw by the Jews in the ghetto. So in that very construct of Yom HaShoah V'Hagvura, you see the internal tension. How do Jews relate to this day? And the reason why that tension exists, in fact, the reason why you have to have a term which both memorialize the destruction and the resistance, is because this day and the memory of the Holocaust more generally represents a problem for the Jewish community. It's not simple. And the problem revolves around what it means to integrate an identity of victimization. What does it mean to think of oneself as a people acted upon, as a people who are the victims of evil and murder? And this is a perennial problem for the Jewish community, and I want to personalize it a little bit. So this is also a strange Yom HaShoah for me, because this is a period in which the Jewish community has witnessed a renewed rise of anti-Semitism in Europe. My son, my eldest son, who's graduating from college next month, was in Paris the very day of the attack on the kosher supermarket. He was going from Israel, where he was visiting, back to New York and had planned to spend a week in Paris with friends. And he was there that day. In fact, he landed just before the attack, and was in Paris for the march that took place in response to the several attacks in Paris at that time. And I have to tell you, it was just very, very difficult for me to have my son there, and feeling this incredible vulnerability as a Jew living in America, born and raised here in the United States, not having felt that vulnerability, despite having traveled throughout Europe and Germany in particular, there was something visceral about the sense that Jews still, in 2015, in Europe, and by the way, it's important to note, France has the largest Jewish community outside of Israel, other than the United States. It has the largest Jewish community in Europe, very vibrant in many ways, and to sense that France, which is the place of the emancipation of the Jews, the Jews were first emancipated in Europe by the French, that is a place in which Jews in such great numbers still feel under threat by a very different kind of anti-Semitism or anti-Jewish violence. That was very, very disconcerting and in many ways shocking. There's something else about this Yom HaShoah, because just earlier, a few days ago, 4 days ago, I believe, Gunter Grass, who is a very, very significant German author and thinker and political activist, Nobel Prize laureate, in the post-war Germany, and really considered by many the conscience of post-war Germany, passed away. And of course, all of the news about his passing and about his life could not ignore the fact that only a few years ago it was revealed that he was, as a young man, a member of the SS during the war. So what does it mean for that great German intellectual and author, who is in many ways an important part of the reconstruction of German identity and German morality after the war, had such a Nazi lineage? One more thing. My last name is Lehmann, spelled with two N's. It's a very German name. My father was born in Leipzig, Germany. And as strange as it sounds, but this is important for people to understand about some of us, I have a very strong sense of my Germanness. And when I go to Germany, in fact, I remember going to Germany, I've been many times, and I went through passport control, and the passport, you know, the border control officer had a name tag, and his name was Lehmann. And of course, he looked at my passport and he said, oh, you know, we have the same name. And the sense that I have of identification with German culture is very strong. My uncle, my father's brother, who's still alive, my father passed away a number of years ago, but my uncle, Uncle Rene, his name is Rene, but Rene was not his given name. I didn't know this until probably about 10 years ago. His name was not Rene. How many German boys are named Rene? His name was Werner. Good German name. And when they left Germany in 1937 and eventually went to Nice, France, wasn't the best place to be. So they ended up leaving there too. But for a while, they were in Nice, France. And my grandparents enrolled my uncle in a French school. The principal in the French school said, you cannot have a child in this school. This was 1938, 39. You can have a child named Werner in the school. So the principal took the letters of Werner and, you know, transposed them and made Rene. Of course, I only knew my uncle as Uncle Rene. That German identity that we have, that I have, in fact, my children have. My children think of themselves as descended from Germans, German Jews. That is very, very deep and profound. And so for me, to think about this day and to think about the Jewish response to Auschwitz, I've been to Auschwitz many times, is particularly personal and difficult. Because on the one hand, of course, it is a place of great Jewish suffering and death. On the other hand, to some degree, there's a part of me that also identifies with the German part of that equation, as strange as that seems. Because in some sense, it was also part of my own history to be a part of the country that perpetrated that. And that creates all kinds of internal problems and tensions. But I want to talk just for a few moments about my theological response, because I actually have deep, deep problems with Auschwitz as a place of dialogue. And I get it. I understand why it's an important place to reflect and to think, even to pray and to converse, to deal with these different, I think, ways of connecting and relating to Auschwitz that Father Manfred mentioned. But here's my issue, and it has to do with my theological mentors. Jews at Auschwitz are placed in a position in which the ground, that soil, the ground upon which we stand there, is one in which dialogue is really, really difficult, because we have to speak and to try to engage others on a landscape in which the victimization of the Jewish people and the Jewish experience of that violence is what surrounds us, is what engulfs us. And frankly, for me, that's not a great place to begin dialogue. I understand what can emerge from that place, because in fact, I think all of us, Germans and Poles and Russians and Jews and Catholics and Protestants and Jews and Muslims, we all have the opportunity at that place to really confront the reality of evil. And that can be a catalyst for some deep theological, ethical reflection, no doubt about it. But I want to share with you the response of one of my teachers who spent most of his life living just a few, probably a mile from here in Brookline, Rabbi Joseph B. Soloveitchik. And he wrote in 1956 an essay called Kol Dodif Dofek, which means My Beloved Knox from Song of Songs. And it was really about the reestablishment of the Jewish state in Israel, and why, from a religious perspective, this was very significant. But he begins by talking about his response to the Holocaust. 1956, not very much afterward. And here's what he says, which I continue to grapple with because I think it's very problematic. He says, there's really nothing to say in the face of this evil about God, about our understanding of the source or the purpose of this evil in the world, because the evil is really beyond our human comprehension. It's, and he uses the word, he says it's a mystery. And our attempt to explain it or understand it or unpack it is futile. So what are we to do? So he says, from his Jewish perspective, and he actually makes the claim that this is a halachic perspective, meaning the perspective of Jewish normative thinking, Jewish law, he says, the only thing we can do is respond by some type of tikkun, some kind of repair. The only thing to do is to think about, well, what does this mean for the further refinement, elevation, and perfection of the human soul? In other words, the suffering has to cause us, even in the midst of the suffering, to think about how does this spur us on to some greater spiritual, ethical perfection? Is how do we take it and actually do something constructive with it? That's the only response from his perspective that is meaningful, that has any chance of actually having any potential value or substance. So of course, in many ways, I think that's problematic. And I was, for a brief time, toward the very end of his teaching career, a student of Rabbi Soloveitchik, but I have come both to be haunted by this and also to be, quite frankly, a struggler with that notion, that somehow the theological questions really we have to bracket, and we can only deal with how we as human beings can move forward in some positive direction. The other teacher of mine in this, who is also a student of Rabbi Soloveitchik's, was Rabbi Irving Greenberg, who is considered one of the foremost Jewish Holocaust theologians, although he doesn't like that term. And he very much, in thinking about, for many, many years, a theological response to the Holocaust, came to the conclusion that the Holocaust does represent a break, a certain kind of break, for the Jewish people in terms of their relationship to God. Not that God does not continue to be in a covenantal relationship with the Jewish people, but that that covenantal relationship needs to take on some new form after the Holocaust, because the Jewish community can no longer be expected by God to continue in that covenant in some kind of commanded way, because where was God to protect the Jews living in that covenantal relationship? And because God was absent or somehow allowed this to happen, the continuation of that covenant now has to be voluntary. It has to be chosen by the Jewish community. And in fact, from his perspective, from Greenberg's perspective, the Jews have chosen to continue that relationship, that covenantal relationship with God. And part of that is, in fact, in the establishment of the State of Israel as a great expression of faith and of commitment. So for Greenberg, this new covenantal moment, this new opportunity brought upon us by the Holocaust, is also an opportunity for Christianity. And in fact, from his perspective, and with this I agree, Christianity has taken that opportunity to rethink in many ways, not only the relationship to the Jewish people, Nostra Aetate, as has been mentioned in Vatican II, but more profoundly, I think, their own theological framework for relationship between Catholics and God. It's not just about how we relate to the Jews. And I think that's why the center that Father Manfred works at and is committed to is so important. Not so much because of the dialogue that's possible there, and I'm sure there are many important conversations and reflections that take place, but as much for the need that the Christian community and the Catholic community in particular has to re-engage in their own theological self-reflection about what it is in Christendom that produced this in the heart of Europe, and what does it mean for the reshaping of Catholic understanding of God. And I think what is most profound to me is the way that the Catholic theological project has in fact reshaped in many ways their conception of that covenantal relationship. And it has been not only impressive to many of us in the Jewish community, but inspiring in terms of the possibility of radical theological renewal. And in many ways, I think the contribution that Auschwitz and the Catholic response to Auschwitz as a symbol, that contribution to the possibility of theological rethinking and reengagement is something that continues to reverberate not only in Catholicism, but throughout the religious world. And I'm grateful for that, very grateful for that. Finally, I just want to end with another one of my teachers. These are all people who think about these issues and are interrelated with one another, and that is Rabbi David Hartman, who passed away a few years ago. And he wrote an essay called Auschwitz or Sinai. And he makes the claim, very different from either Greenberg or Soloveitchik, that Auschwitz is a problem for the Jewish community, especially in Israel where he lived, because if people think that the state of Israel is primarily a product and a response of Auschwitz, then the Jewish people and the state of Israel more generally has been built on very unstable ground. And what he claims is that the Jewish state needs to be less about a memorialization or a rebirth in the aftermath of Auschwitz, and it more has to be a response to the covenant with God at Sinai, which is basically about the Jewish future. It's basically about how do we envision a Jewish society in relationship to God as it gets expressed in a political, economic, and social reality of Jewish autonomy and sovereignty. And he makes a very, very strong claim, Sinai, not Auschwitz. And he's not belittling the necessity of thinking about Auschwitz and having that memory continue to echo in our minds. But if that becomes the basis of our theological thinking, if that becomes the basis of our understanding of what Judaism is ultimately a response to, if it's a response to Auschwitz and not a response to God's revelation at Sinai, then from his perspective, the Jewish future will always be limited and handicapped by the shadow of Auschwitz. And I think for many of us, including those of us who have parents with direct experiences before and during the war in Europe, for many of us, I think we live in that tension between the extent to which Auschwitz continues to be a significant part of our thinking about ourselves as Jews, about God, and about Judaism more generally, and the need to ensure that Auschwitz is not the fundamental framework with which we think about ourselves or about Jewish life now and in the future. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Danny. And we have about 10 minutes or so for questions. There is a mobile mic over there, so if you have a question, you can direct it to either one of our speakers. Emma, you want to, over here. Maybe since you're sitting right there, you could just come up and use this mic. All right, okay.
Thanks to both of you. I was struck by your quoting of Soloveitchik's idea that dialogue is really not possible or certainly not a good idea after Auschwitz. And that he said that really what is needed, the only thing that can be done is tikkun. I'm also struck by Father Deselaers, your speaking about how there is very little dialogue going on often, and often they're just people being together and very slowly, gradually developing relationships, if I understood you correctly. And it seems to me that that is a tikkun, and that even though Soloveitchik may have not said that because I know he was quite generally opposed to interreligious dialogue, that perhaps that relationship building and sitting together in silence is a tikkun. And I'm wondering what perhaps either of you would have to say to that idea. Thank you very much.
You can.
Well, just a couple of things. I wasn't so much referring to Soloveitchik's resistance to interfaith dialogue, although that is certainly true, he was. And he wrote about that elsewhere. This was more about, even within the Jewish community, should we be responding to the Holocaust or other kinds of Jewish historical tragedies with theological ponderings about the source of evil, the nature of God's relationship to evil, all of those kinds of things, which he felt led us nowhere, and instead felt that we had to respond in terms of our own human need to somehow correct our own ethical and religious ways of life in order to respond to the suffering by some human refinement. But I do think that, first of all, I think, you know, personally, I'm very, very committed to inter-religious learning, conversation, and exchange of ideas. And I do think an inter-religious presence and experience and opportunity in Auschwitz makes sense to me. For me, if I was to choose where I'd want to have serious dialogue with other religious traditions and Christianity in particular, that would not be where I'd want to do it, just because I think it puts us on a very uneven ground. You know, I actually think that the United States ends up being a very, very good place, not Europe, for some of the most fruitful conversations across those tables. Maybe even here in Boston is one of the best.
Did you want to respond also?
I am sitting in Oświęcim, so this is my place. But the longer the more, I am also convinced about what means tikkun, what means healing after Auschwitz. Auschwitz was not only killing of people, it was began with killing of relationships. So healing is about relationships, healing, how can we learn to trust one another? And for me the issues is not theological theory, but crucial experiences were in these seminars, for example, with Michael Signer, already the very beginning that we visited together the camp. It was to be together, a Jewish rabbi who was the first time after the war, no, not after the war, in his life in Auschwitz, but his part of his family was killed there. Jewish students, German priests, and their students, professors, Poles, together, we have made the guided tour. Together we went to the crematorium in Birkenau, and maybe from this experience, three examples. One of the Jewish girls on the long way in Birkenau, Ram, stayed behind, and in the evening, in sharing, they told those stories. And when she cried and was sat down, and when she looked up, she saw the whole group was very far away already, and she felt horribly lost. Horribly lost. She felt how the people in Auschwitz then, the Jews, felt lost, by all the, left alone by the old world. And she felt even worse. But then she saw suddenly that someone was standing next to her. This was one of the German students. He had seen that she stayed behind and simply stood there and waited for her, not doing anything. And this became so important for her. And this is one example. It's good to be together in this place. And when we go there, we don't only think what it does mean for me, also we think what does it mean for him. The same experience was when we were with CCJ.
Yeah.
And this is what I mean with the beginning of Tikkun in Auschwitz. And also seeing the Israeli groups alone, seeing the German groups alone, seeing the Polish groups alone. The longer, the more I feel the real chilling is not only memory, the real chilling is to be together, to come together. And nobody can make Tikkun alone, because it's about destroyed relationships. And the question is, how can we trust one another again? How can we build a common world? And my dream is that this answer of being together begins already in Auschwitz.
So let me just interject one thing. I think that is very powerful, and I haven't experienced it because I've only gone with Jewish groups, and I need to go in an interreligious context. I can see and understand how that is an important beginning. What I want to interject or just add is that for me, the real challenge of the tikkun, of the healing, needs to take place in ways in which the relationships can be constructed and renewed from context and places of life. There's something about Auschwitz and Birkenau which to me are beyond the source of any kind of normalcy. And therefore, it's, to me, the challenge, I've actually said this here at Boston College before, the challenge to me of Jews and Catholics and others living together intentionally with real openness and respect for the religious otherness that you expressed, but in places of life. For me, Auschwitz is a place only of Jewish death. There are no Jews there. There aren't going to be Jews there. And that's not a place out of which we can really build those kinds of lasting relationships that are going to be ultimately, I think, the kind of repair that is required. We have to do that out of places of real life and communal vitality. And so again, I think there are important things that can happen there, and tikkun that can, healing that can start, and important powerful experiences. My preference in terms of energies is around places where that can be really sustained because they're living, vibrant communities.
I think our time is up, but just one word, which is to say that you began by invoking also that today was the culmination of the March of the Living, which is a bit of a ritual for Israeli high school kids, also many American kids who go and study for a year in high year after high school go on something similar. But one of the discussions that's going on around the March of the Living today is that there is another dimension of living which needs to be added to that, not just visiting where Polish Jewry died, but engaging with the living Poland today. And that's part of this meeting of peoples. When the International Conference of Christians and Jews met in Krakow and we spent a day in Auschwitz and Auschwitz, we started off doing some thinking and reflecting together. We toured, but we broke up into different groups for tours. So the Germans went separately, German Christians went separately. The German Jews decided not to go with the German Christians, but they came with the English-speaking groups. I think there was maybe also a French-speaking group. But then when we went to Birkenau and we took this march along the path of the railroad tracks that led to the crematoria, and that was a prayerful march, that we did together. So we confronted it together. We confronted the memories separately. We confronted these differences. But then we also came together as human beings in dialogue. And that's a piece of the power of that experience also.
So I hope that there's something that we can walk out of this room with hope in our hearts, with renewed prayer and desire and energy to work towards the repair of the world, because that's what really matters in the end. We have history, but we have to make the world a better place. So thank you, everybody.